Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
So today evening is Diwali, and I'll speak today on the topic of light and darkness. When you talk about this theme, one of the most famous and the most famous Upanishadic statements is Tamasoma Jyotirgama. Move from darkness to light. And in one sense, if we look at our own lives, nobody wants to be in darkness. Even if somebody wants to do something in darkness, so somebody wants to rob or steal, but they want to have enough light so that they can do it, but they don't want others to see the light to see them. So in that sense, nobody actually wants darkness. Who would not want to go from darkness to light? Everybody, because in light is where we can see, we can act, we can do things. But then, if it's just a simple common sense directive, go from darkness to light. But what does it mean? Actually, if you look at the context, there are three sayings over there. Mrityurma Amrutamangama. So, go from immortality to immortality. Asatoma Sadgamena. That go from that which is unreal to that which is real. So now, that is the context where this call comes up. Go from darkness to light. So darkness is associated with temporariness, and darkness is associated with unreality. And go from darkness to light. When this statement comes up in the Upanishads, we see in the broad Vedic body of knowledge, what is taught in the Upanishads, that is, in so many ways, demonstrated in the Puranas and the Itihasas. So historically, Diwali is celebrated when the residents of Ayodhya are delighted and they are welcoming Lord Ram back. And when they are welcoming the Lord back, at that time, they offer him, they light the whole of Ayodhya with lamps to welcome him. And that also represents the lighting of their own hearts. So the ultimate light of the heart comes when our heart becomes illuminated by the presence of the supremely luminous being. That is the Supreme Lord. So I'll talk about this theme of the Festival of Lights in terms of four quadrants. We are talking here about not just simple light and darkness, but the light of knowledge, spiritual knowledge, which helps us to see the ultimate reality. So we could say that the four quadrants are, we are in dark and we know we are in dark. That's so not dark, state and awareness. We are in dark, we are aware we are in dark. We are in dark, but we think we are in light. We are in light, but we think we are in dark. And we are in light and we know we are in light. So, which is the best state to be in? We are in light and to be aware that we are in light. Which is the worst state to be in?
But we think we are in light.
Yes. Now, actually, from an emotional perspective, from an experiential perspective, to be in dark and to think that we are in, to know that we are in dark is most painful. But we will get out of it because it's unbearable, it's unlivable state to be. But to be in dark and to think that we are in light. So that is, we could say, if you want to give one identifying describer for each of these. So to be in dark and to know that we are in dark is to be miserable. To be in dark and to think that we are in light is to be deluded. We are deluded because of the illusion. To be in light and to not know that we are in light, To be light and to think that we are in dark, that is the state of doubtfulness. And to be in light and to know that we are in light, that is the state of enlightenment, to be enlightened. So, here if we consider when we live in the world, when we say we are in dark, if we are driving along a road and suddenly everything is dark, not only are there no lights on the road, but even our own car's street headlights go away, then we immediately come to a stop. Should I move forward? What should I do? What should I not do? So to be dark and to be in the state of darkness, to be aware that we are in dark, that means to be in a state where we don't know what to do. And then at that time we look, what should I do? What should I do at that time? So Arjuna at the start of the Bhagavad-Gita was in the first, initially was in the second quadrant. He was, of course, Arjuna is an enlightened soul, but Krishna is teaching us something through him. And therefore, what Krishna does is, he uses a particular method. He puts Arjuna into illusion. So Arjuna has a plan for his life. He's a Kshatriya, and the Kshatriya, he has to fight a war. He has to gain the kingdom, which has been stolen from his family, and he wants to have Yudhishthira enthroned as the king. But then he starts thinking, is this fight worth it? So much bloodshed, so much killing of loved ones, what is really worth it? And then when he says, Nachaitad vidma katarano gariyo, yadva jaye me divano jayeyo, yane bhatva najiji vishamas, deyavastata pramukhe dhartarashtra. I just don't see any good option. All options are bad over here. So that is the state when he surrenders to Krishna. So he is initially in that second stage, but he comes to the first quadrant, second quadrant to first quadrant. And that's the, in the Bhagavad Gita takes Arjuna from a journey from the first quadrant to the fourth quadrant. Fourth quadrant is where he becomes enlightened. Now for all of us, we also come at times in our lives and we have particular plans for our life. This is what I'm going to do, this is what I'm going to do. And some plans work, some don't work, but we keep moving on. But sometimes such reversals come, such adversities come upon us, we start questioning, is life worth it? Why am I doing anything at all? And at that time, It is actually very, it is a very disorienting state to be. Is anything worth doing at all? I was once giving a class on this 327 in the Bhagavad Gita. Prakrite kriyamanani gunai karmani sarvashah ahankara vimudhatma karta hamiti manyate. So, and I was giving this class and at that time, I asked this question. It says, you know, the Bhagavad Gita says that everything is done by the modes, and one who thinks that they are the doers are an illusion. So this raises many questions. So what are the questions that are raised? So I was thinking, expecting that, you know, we do things. How is it that the modes are doing actually? We work and everything. So one devotee, he was known in the devotee community to be quite a lazy person. So he asks, what question comes? He says, some question comes, why should I do anything? If the modes are doing everything, then why should I do anything? So then I said that every time when the time for prasad comes, we don't ask, why should I do anything? We are eager to eat prasad. It comes to for us in the sadhaka stage, eating and sleeping are the most cherished pastimes. And then, hearing and chanting, they are like the austere prescribed duties. So, actually, when we say that the modes are doing everything, what is the need to do anything? So, in this stage, when we are in the fourth quadrant, we genuinely feel, I just don't know what to do. And that is the time most likely we seek knowledge. But many people live in the second quadrant, because the first quadrant is more or less unlivable. We have to get out of that as quickly as possible. Now, where we get out, that depends on our past inclinations, that depends on our association, that depends on our free will. So most people go to the second quadrant, where they think they are in knowledge, but they don't actually know. So they are in darkness, but to think that they are in light. In fact, one of the names for the Rakshasas is Nishachara. Nishachara means those who move at night. So now, physically there is darkness, but actually their vision becomes more acute. Like owls, who can see very well at night, they also become active at night. I think night is a good time to act and to attack and everything like that. So when we are in the second quadrant, where we think we know, the result of that is that we don't even try to come out of our, come to real light, because we think we are in light. And this is where the two energies of illusion, there are two energies, are Avaranatmika Shakti and Prakshepatmika Shakti. So it is the covering potency and the throwing potency. So to understand these two energies, it's simple ways. We can consider a movie theater. As soon as we enter in a movie theater, one light goes off and another light goes on. So the lights around us, all of them go off. And then we can't see much around us. That's the Avaranatmika Shakti. Everything else we can't see. And in the Prakshepatmika Shakti is, one light goes on. So then we just, our attention gets glued to the screen. So our consciousness gets hurled towards that. So at that time, we get caught in a particular illusion that is being projected, and we start experiencing that to be the reality. So most of us, we live in this state, and it is not often that we remember that we are living over here. That is, we could say the bodily conception of life, within which we can all take up various causes. So within this, somebody can live in sattva, rajas, tamas, more or less enlightened states, or more or less aware states, but they're all spiritually unaware states. And in the last few centuries, scientific knowledge has advanced tremendously, and the result of that is more and more people have come to the second level, and they think that is the enlightened level. Now when the this is second level. The third level would be what? We are in knowledge, we are in light, but we don't know we are in light. We still think we are in darkness. The problem with the world is actually not ignorance. The problem with the world is that the wise people are doubtful and the foolish people are ultra confident. Those who don't know anything, I'm perfectly sure this is how it is. So we see, when we practice bhakti, many times we make questions, does the spiritual world really exist? Does Krishna really care for me? Will I attain that? There are so many questions. But when people pursue materialistic goals, they have no doubt at all, if I just get this promotion, my life is going to be successful. If I just get this, I wrote a book on reincarnation, and I've answered questions, a lot of questions on the incarnation. So one of the most amusing questions was that one person asked me that I'm in love with a girl, and we wanted, both of us want to get married, but somehow our families are violently opposed and it's not working out. So can you tell me what karma I can do so that I can marry her in my next life?
So in Bollywood, there is a lot of depiction of reincarnation, and reincarnation is used primarily as a plot twist to just extend. Okay, there's a tragedy in this life, but then there's a reunion in the next life. So the conception of reincarnation has been romanticized quite a bit. Romanticized and sensationalized. So many people have this idea of a soulmate.
You know, how can we find our soulmate? I usually say, first find your soul. So when we have particular kind of desires, at that time we may have knowledge, even if we have knowledge of reincarnation. But there is knowledge and there is the purpose of knowledge. So if we are not aware of the purpose of knowledge, then that knowledge doesn't have much value. I may know how to operate a complicated computer, but if I don't really know what a computer is meant to be used for, and I just use a very high-end computer simply for playing video games, then with the computer I can do a lot more things. So then I may have that knowledge, but I don't really understand that I am in knowledge. I am in light, but I don't realize I am in light. So many people who say grow up in a spiritual culture, who grow up in a spiritual society, spiritual family, they have knowledge, but they are not really aware that they have that knowledge. And because of that, they are always looking outward, looking elsewhere for something else. The American thinker, Mark Twain, he said that when I was 15, my father was a fool. Now he's 25, and I am amazed how much the old guy has learned in the last 10 years.
So now it's not so much the old guy that the father has learned, but the way that person thinks at 15 and the way the person thinks at 25 is very different. So at 15 and just the teenage hormones are coming out and one just wants to be free. But by 25 one is taking up more responsibility. Then one starts appreciating the other perspectives also.
So even if one has knowledge, one has wisdom, one has light, but one doesn't realize that they have light, then that is a state also of deprivation. And beyond that is the state of the fourth quadrant. What is that? Yeah, we have light and we are aware that we have light. So for those of us who have started practicing bhakti, we are to some extent in the, we oscillate. It's not that we are permanently in one quadrant, but to some extent we are in the third quadrant. We are trying to move toward the fourth quadrant. So now if we consider what is the ultimate light, we could say it's the light of knowledge. Yes, that is true, but it's more than knowledge. Ultimately, there is a source of knowledge, and that source of knowledge is the Supreme Person. And that Supreme Person is all attractive, is all loving. And the Bhagavad Gita says that the ultimate light is the light that comes from devotion. The Chaturshloki Bhagavad Gita is where Krishna first says, I am the Supreme. Those who understand Him, they become Buddha. Aham sarvasya prabhava matta sarvam pravartate iti matva bhajante mam buddha bhava samanvitaha. That they become wise and they constantly delight in discussing about me. At the next Vatesham Satata Yuktana. No, Machitta Madgata Prana. But then what if somebody knows Krishna but they don't become wise? Then Krishna answers that in 10:10. And he says, for them I make them wise. Tesham Satata Yuktanam Bhajitam Priti Purvakam Dadami Buddhi Yogam Tam Yenamam Upayantite Ayudan the Buddhi. And somebody may say that, but what if they are ignorant? That is the last verse. Tesham Evanu Kampartham Ahamagyana Jantama Nashayamyatma Bhavastho Jnana Deepena Bhasvataha. So Jnana Deepena Bhasvataha, I illumine them with knowledge. So the ultimate knowledge is the knowledge that comes from bhakti. So because ultimately we don't just long to know, we long to love. The heart's deepest longing is not just a longing for knowledge. It's a longing for love, a loving connection, a loving relationship. And that comes when we find the ultimate object of love. So the Bhagavad Gita says the ultimate enlightenment is to know whom to love. Yomameva asammudo janati purushottamam sa sarvavid bhajati mam sarva bhavena bharata. Sarva bhavena bharata. With the whole heart, when we understand that Krishna is the ultimate object of love, that is the enlightened state. Sa sarvavid. The person knows everything. So this is the philosophical context. And coming to the Ramayana, which is the historical context for this particular Diwali festival. The whole idea is that if we consider in the Ramayana, there are characters who are in all the different quadrants. And the Ayodhya Vasis, when Ram is with them, they are jubilant. But when Ram is exiled, they just sink into darkness. Just don't know what to live for, what to do. Every single day, they're longing, when will Ram come back? When will Ram come back? When will Ram come back? Then, if you consider Kaikeyi, at least when she has Ram exiled, she thinks she knows what is going on. She thinks there's a conspiracy afoot to deprive her son of the kingship. And that's why she vehemently protests. And then, so she is in the second quadrant. Now, of course, we can also say there are the Akshasas in the second quadrant, but let's focus on Ayodhya. Because Diwali is centered on that Ayodhya. The lamps are lit when all the Ayodhya Vasis welcome Krishna back, welcome Ram back. Now, when Ram returns, it is the Brajavas, it is the Ayodhya Vasis who are in great distress. And while they are in distress, at that time, they are longing. If we consider Bharat, he is not even ready to have any royal comforts at all. He is waiting and he tells Ram that if you don't come after 14 years, you come even one day late, so you will find my dead body. I won't be able to live any further. And then he takes Ram's padukas. He says, please give me your shoes, your sandals, and I will put them on the throne. You know, if today's world, say, there is maybe a big wealthy person dies and their children are fighting, and one brother gives his shoes to the other brother, the other brother will take it and bang it on his head.
Not carry it on his own head.
So often there are succession struggles which break out, and the succession struggles are usually because of selfishness. I want everything. In the Ramayana also, after Dashrath's departure, there is a succession struggle. Succession conflict is there. But that succession conflict is because of selflessness. That. Both of them are saying, Ram is telling Bharat, you be the king. And Bharat is saying, Ram, you be the king. So that is extraordinary. So although Bharat has that great devotion, but still he feels with the separation from Ram, my life and heart is dark. And thus, there is illusion, there is delusion. There is distress, not illusion, but distress. And generally, when the Lord descends to the world, see, is it that every single person, when the Lord descends to the world, is everyone already a pure devotee? What do you think? When the Lord descends? Well, there are certainly the intimate associates of the Lord who are already exalted devotees. But there are others who are fortunate to be there and they become elevated. So even at that time, when the Lord performs some miraculous activities, Lord does something extraordinary, then that attracts people. And even when He is there, it's not that everybody is convinced that He is the Lord, not that everybody is devoted to Him. So there are people who are in the presence of the Lord, but they don't necessarily accept Him as the Lord. Now, of course, the demons are there. They are in the presence, but some of them accept. Some of them don't accept. Vibhishan comes over to Ram's side. And then Vibhishan not only comes over to Ram's side for the war, but Vibhishan also comes for the coronation. In fact, Vibhishan gives the pushpaka with which Ram returns to Ayodhya. So the Lord, when the festival of lights, which happens in Ayodhya, that is a historical event, but that is also an eternal event that is meant to happen in our own hearts. Our heart is like Ayodhya. And we might be in any of the other three quadrants. And we pray that the light of bhakti, the light of prema, illumine our heart. And we realize and relish that illumination. That is what we aspire for. And whatever level we might be at, if we are in the first, second or third quadrants, the Lord is attractive enough to bring us to Him. Wherever we may be, if we have doubts, if we are in the third quadrant, we can pray to the Lord that we find out the ways by which those doubts can be destroyed. So usually if we consider, if we have desires, we move. If we have doubts, we don't move. So doubts and desires are two forces that come from our subtle body. And usually if somebody is in the first quadrant, just don't know what to do. They have doubts and they have no desires. Is anything worth doing at all? So from there, the doubts are removed and then devotional divine desires are created. Bhakti is the process where we desire to love and serve the Lord and do as much as we can to share His glories with others. Sometimes we go to the second quadrant because we have a lot of desires and we get caught in those desires. So then in that case, sometimes the darkness is caused because of the presence of doubts. Sometimes the darkness is caused because of the presence of worldly desires. Then from there we need purification in the sense of the removal of desires. And then as those desires get removed, then we start moving towards the light. Sometimes we may be in the third quadrant where we have spiritual knowledge but still we have a lot of doubts. And for us, the elevation toward the journey towards enlightenment requires the removal of the doubts. The removal of the doubts is what will take us toward the Lord. So, you know, we all have doubts. But what our challenge is, not the problem is not having doubts. The problem is believing our doubts. Yeah, when we believe our doubts, we need to, what happens is, often we believe our doubts and we doubt our beliefs. But instead, we can learn to, okay, this is a doubt. But maybe the doubt is not the ultimate. We can doubt our doubts. Let me evaluate it. So there are proper ways in which we can address our doubts. But whatever it is that is keeping us in darkness, we pray that the Lord remove it from our heart. And as the Lord removes it from our heart, then this state of enlightenment, that state where we are in light and we appreciate that we are in light, that manifests in our life. And that happens by the mercy of the Lord and His devotees. So on special festivals like Diwali, the Lord's mercy is available more and more. And Srila Prabhupada has given us the Krishna consciousness movement where we can get this light and we can get the awareness of this light. And if we stay in the association of devotees and seek this light, seek the light of prema, light of Shuddha Bhakti, then the Lord's blessings are there for every one of us to elevate us upward. So although it was in Ayodhya itself, the conspiracy had happened by which the Lord was sent away, but still the Lord came back. So the Lord, although the Ayodhya Vasis sent Lord Ram away, but Lord Ram didn't abandon them. So similarly for us, even if we have turned away from the Lord never turns away from us. He is always with us. His love for us is not based on our goodness. His love for us is based on His godliness. Means we may be pious, we may be impious, we may be pure, we may be impure. His love for us is not based on that. Everyone, He offers His love. And wherever somebody might be, we just turn toward the Lord. Then He is ready to illumine each and every heart with the supreme light of bhakti. And that is what we can pray for on the sacred occasion of Diwali. Pray to the Lord and pray to the Lord's great devotees so that they can bless our hearts. And this festival of light can happen not just through the beautiful lights that we light outside our homes, but also through the light of spiritual knowledge and the light of divine love or bhakti that illumines our heart. So I'll summarize. I spoke today on this topic of Diwali, and I spoke of how this famous saying in the Upanishads, go from light, darkness to light, is illustrated in the epics, such as the Ramayana. So it is not just talking about simple physical darkness to physical light. We're talking about the darkness that keeps us in mortality and ignorance or asatta, in that non-existent, in the temporary. From there, we move to immortality and reality. That what is that light? To understand that, I talk about these four quadrants. What are the first quadrant?
Miserable.
So we are in dark and we are aware that we are in dark. We will want to get out of it. And most people can't stay there for very long. But if we are there, it seems miserable, but it can also be the doorway to fortune. What is the second quadrant?
Delusion.
We are in darkness, but we think we are in light. So that is the path of material progress to the exclusion of spiritual progress. So we have the light to pursue worldly things, but we don't recognize that they're all ultimately temporary. And from this sector to come out is not so easy. We have to either come down or to go to the higher sectors usually. What are the third one?
Doubt.
That is, we have light, but we don't realize that we have light. That is the state when we are caught in a state where we don't appreciate what we have. And many of us as spiritual sadhakas are in that state. We may oscillate between various states. But the fourth state is the state of we are in light, enlightenment. We are in light and we know that we are in light. So we can say that when there are doubts and desires are two obstructions. The doubts and worldly desires, we could say. So whatever be the obstacle, the light can remove both of them. Light can expose to us the futility of worldly desires, and light can expose to us the hollowness of our doubts. And through that, we can move towards the state of enlightenment. And for each one of us, wherever we are, the Lord always is there with us. Ayodhya Vasi is, send the Lord away, the Lord still came. Lord didn't abandon them. So the Lord's love for us is not based on our goodness, but on His godliness. He's the all-loving parent of everyone. And if we just turn towards Him and seek His prayers and seek His mercy, He will elevate us from wherever we may be. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna. Any questions? Yes, please.
So, you mentioned that the sadhakas, we tend to be in the third and fourth quadrants. And truly you're aware of the verse in Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 3, Chapter 29, Verse 8, that one who is angry, violent, and a separatist is one who performs devotional service in darkness.
Yeah.
So it seems to me that that's even more dangerous for a sadhaka than for, you know, someone who doesn't know anything.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah, actually, to be in a state where we are in, say, performing bhakti in the mode of darkness, as it is said, that is a dangerous state. Yes, it is that if we don't know anything about Krishna, then we may do wrongs in the sense of we may commit sins. But if we know about Krishna and still keep doing wrongs, they may be will be offenses. And offenses are often more dangerous than sins. That's one way of looking at it. Another way is also that we cannot wish away the modes that we were born with. We want to work ourselves out of them, we want to work them away. But we are born with a particular mode. So we could, that whole section, I've given a series of three classes on bhakti in the three modes. But that whole section illustrates, you can see it from two perspectives. One is, that when we are practicing bhakti, you can't assume that just because I am practicing bhakti, I am transcendental. That I have to see in which mode I am functioning. And we try to elevate ourselves to a progressively higher level of consciousness. And so especially if somebody is performing bhakti in the mode of ignorance, and in the street of darkness, and they think what I am doing is equivalent to what a pure devotee is doing or what a devotee in goodness is doing. Then that is where the problem comes up. But if the other perspective is that bhakti is so inclusive that even somebody in tamoguna can practice it. The practices like jnana or yoga, it is very, very difficult for somebody who doesn't have some strong level of sattva to practice them. So we can say that that bhakti is inclusive in the sense that even those who are in the lowest of modes can also start practicing bhakti. But the pretext of the practice of bhakti is that, okay, that we rise from the lower modes higher. So it is Krishna's love that he accepts even those who are functioning in the mode of ignorance. But what is, if we stay in the mode of ignorance, then where is our love for Krishna? So we need to strive to rise. So we don't reject somebody who is in the mode of ignorance. So if somebody just functionally that way, then they'll function in that way itself. And is that dangerous? Well, it's dangerous if they are complacent and they think that this is equivalent to what anybody else is doing. But if it is, if that is the only way they will get elevated, then they have to be accommodated. If you consider Srila Prabhupada, how he dealt with many of the hippies during the counterculture, he accommodated them. Many of them, when they would come for classes, they would come high on drugs. And Prabhupada still tried to calm them down and try to speak them. If Prabhupada had said that, that you know, no, anybody who is high, they should not come for the class. And there will be nobody left for the class then. So Prabhupada was accommodating, but still Prabhupada did not, Prabhupada accepted them. See, there are two aspects in the practice of bhakti. One is accepting people where they are. And second is encouraging them to rise upward. So sometimes if we just only accept, then they may not rise at all. And if you only emphasize on rising, but you don't accept where they are, then they feel very uncomfortable and they feel judged and rejected. So both aspects are required. That accept people where they are, but also show them the hierarchy. We don't hide the hierarchy, that trajectory. The word hierarchy can sound a little sectarian, a little judgmental. But that is the trajectory. This is the path we are all meant to move up. So we need to do the right thing. So when somebody needs acceptance, we offer them that. When somebody needs a little push to rise up, then that also needs to be offered. Does that answer your question?
Yes.
Thank you. Yes.
Hare Krishna. In our tradition, we heard Diwali was celebrated when Ram was coming back from back to Ayodhya. And also in Krishna Leela, Damodar pastime happened on the Diwali day.
Correct.
But in India, from when we grew up, we hear that Krishna killing Narakasura is the cause for Diwali. But where this comes from, or what is the reference for that?
Okay, so Krishna killing Narakasura is also the cause for Diwali. Well, if you consider historically, many festivals in India are clustered together. So if you consider Diwali for 4 or 5 days, there's Bali Pratipada is there, when Bali Maharaj surrenders to the Lord, that is also one day. Then there are many other festivals which also come at the same time. Usually there's Lakshmi Puja that is done. So what happened traditionally in India was that while there was understanding there's one Supreme Lord, but there are many other, that one Lord himself was worshipped in many forms, and there are other devatas also were worshipped. So over the centuries, many of the festivals are clubbed together. And now as far as Krishna killing Narakasura, there is, Rupa Goswami says there is Shastra Praman and there is a Loka Praman. In the Bhakti Samasindhu he says, so as far as the Bhagavatam doesn't give a date specifically of when Narakasura was killed. It doesn't mention that. But much of what we celebrate, the festivals and specific ways in which you celebrate the festivals, that doesn't always come from Shastra. That comes from the tradition. So when Loka means, it's not just the public opinion. What he says is that Loka here refers to those who are already, those Loka people who are already devoted to the Lord. their understanding. So, for example, if you go to Vrindavan, many Vrajavasis, devotees who have really devoted their life to Vrindavan and to Krishna, they may tell many stories about Krishna which you may not find directly in the Shastras. But those stories don't necessarily have to be rejected just because they are not found in the Shastra. They can be accepted in Loka Pramana. So quite often the exact dates of many festivals, they may or may not come from Shastra, they may come from the tradition. Okay, thank you.
So isn't it Narakasura was referred in Bhagavad as a Bhaumasura, who's son of and then Krishna killed him with Satyabhama, went to
correct. But is there a date mentioned? I don't think the date is mentioned. The date?
During the one of the chapters.
But I was saying this question was that why is it associated with Diwali?
It's not mentioned, it's in the Karthik, of course. But it has pastime happened.
But pastime is there.
The Parijata, all those things.
Yeah.
It's also there in Mahabharata where Bhaumasura's son, the Bhagavad-Gītā.
Yeah, of course.
So he was killed.
Yeah. Pastime is that Narakasura story is quite well known. His question is more about the date of the festival. Yeah.
I do have a question.
Yeah, sure.
No problem.
Okay. So a couple of questions. So the third quadrant. People have light. I was thinking what they are in light.
Sorry?
Having light and they're thinking that they are in the darkness. But they are in the light, but they're thinking the darkness. So some of the people like Nabhaktina talk or some people out of humility, they have to say I'm worse than stool, one in the stool. So it's some of the devotees also out of humility or they mention that. Do they also fall in the same category? They are in light, but they think they are in the darkness.
It's a good question. Okay, first disclaimer. That any kind of categorization that we do, all categorizations are conceptual tools. Reality never falls very neatly into categories. So if you consider a map, now on a map you might say this is America and this is Canada. But if you actually go geographically, you know, is this place in America or this place in Canada? There could be a dispute about that. If you say, okay, this river is the boundary. Well, is it that 50% of the water of the river is belonging to America, 50% to America? Okay, so any kind of conceptual categorization that we do, we can always place, when real life when we apply that categorization, it is not, everything is not so neatly fitting into categories. So categorization is often a tool to understand things. And so for example, we say there are four categories of people who come to Krishna. And we say Dhruva was Artharthi. He was seeking wealth. But then Dhruva was also Artho, isn't it? He was also very distressed. He was felt so afflicted by his mother's words that he just left home. Being unable to bear that affliction. So we could, any categorization is not necessarily black and white. So with that disclaimer, to move forward, we can say that there are Uttamadhikaris and there are Madhyamadhikaris. So Uttamadhikaris are those who see the world as filled with only devotees. And they cannot really preach. They cannot really give Krishna to anyone because they think everybody has Krishna. Everybody is already serving Krishna. But who can give Krishna? Those who are Madhyama level. They can see, okay, this person is practicing bhakti, this person is not practicing bhakti. And whatever is stopping this person from practicing bhakti, let me help to remove that. Now, when great Vaishnavas, they act humbly or they make compositions. Bhaktivinoda Thakur says, Amara Jeevana Sada Paperata. So that is a state where they are seeing the greatness of Krishna so much and they are experiencing the love of Krishna so much that they think, what am I doing to reciprocate with it? And when that awareness of Krishna's greatness and Krishna's love is so prominent that they feel whatever I am doing is nothing. And thus they feel, oh, Krishna has done so much for me, I have done nothing for Krishna. I am such a fallen person. I am such a sinner. So that is because of a very high level of awareness of Krishna. So which category would it fall in? You could say it could fall in the third. But it is, we also understand it is a, they, that is out of their humility, out of their great absorption in Krishna, that they are, when we say they are taking the role of a sadhaka, that doesn't mean they are artificially doing that, they actually feel like that. But they feel like that because they think Krishna is so great and I am so small. So you could say that they are in the third category. Yeah.
So second part of the question, so you made a wonderful statement, sir. Strive for, not just for knowledge, but for the love.
Yeah.
I mean, paraphrasing.
Correct.
You said that. So now, can you say more about it? Because what happened, the love, L-O-V-E, is highly used, highly misunderstood. And then even among the devotee communities now, it's like the love, 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 just love, just love. And what does that mean, love, when you say from that perspective? Because everybody has their own definitions. So if you can share some.
Okay, yeah. So, everybody has their own definition of love. Yeah, I have a whole class on five definitions of love. It means basically love as emotion, love as attraction. Love as emotion means we feel loved in somebody's presence. Love as attraction, that somebody says, I'm in love, it means we feel overwhelmingly attracted to that person. Love as expectation, you don't love me anymore. That is love as expectation. Then there is love as action. There is love as, love is expressed to action. Then love is not just a noun, it's also a verb.
It's a duty.
Yeah, love is done through what is needed for the other person, we do that. And action that leads further to love as dedication. Not just through the action, but we are committed. Love as commitment or dedication. There are various aspects of love. So similarly, if you consider bhakti, many people, when they talk about bhakti, they think of bhakti as emotion. So, oh, when I come to the temple, I feel so good. I feel so good. They say that when I have the bhav in my heart, then I will chant the holy names. Then I will surrender my life to Krishna. And then, now the problem is that bhav, there is abhav. There is a shortage of that kind of bhav always. That emotion is not there. So the way the acharyas have explained bhakti, we could say that's also devotional love or divine love. It is not an emotion. It is not even an expectation. In fact, our acharyas say, have no expectation of the Lord. Anya bhilashita shunyam jnana karma adhyanavartam anukulena krishnanu shilanam bhaktiruttama. So shilanam means cultivation. So devotion is not just emotion, but it is essentially conscious, continuous cultivation. So shilanam, conscious, continuous cultivation. We try to cultivate our heart so that the bhaktilata beach can grow within that heart. So that is the essence. If we start focusing on love as emotion, or love as expectation, or love as attraction, then we may sometimes feel it and sometimes not feel it at all. So one day we feel, oh, I love Krishna. I leave the whole world and just surrender my whole life to Krishna. Next day we feel, does Krishna even exist? So we will oscillate like that. That's why we need to focus on this, the idea of love as action and love as dedication. That's why Prabhupada translated bhakti also not just as devotion, but as devotional service. So love, and if we are trying to develop our love for Krishna, that means we focus on love as action and dedication. Not see much. Thank you. Yes,
Prabhuji, this is more a comment and a question. Thank you. This is the first time I've heard that Bhagavatam verse. Could the import of the verse be, and I haven't read Prabhupada's purport, I think every religion or philosophy has its share of fanatical people. And sometimes I've observed that the most religious people happen to be the least tolerant and the most judgmental. Is the point of the knowledge and the purpose of the knowledge to always look inward, subjectively ask ourselves, among these four quadrants, where am I? And not about where is this person or that person?
Okay.
That the,
okay, yes, very good question. That is often the people who are the most religious tend to be the most fanatical. Yes, it's unfortunate fact that religion is often used more for proving than for improving.
instead of improving my own consciousness, we focus on proving I am right. So instead of developing our own love for Krishna, we often focus on proving what you are doing in Krishna's service is wrong. So that becomes a big problem. Yeah, so the inward focus is always good. And ultimately, that's what is in our control. So there is a, for that, you could have, there's another, I have another class with four quadrants. I won't go into that, but I can make it briefly. So there is concern for people and concern for process. So if you could say again, four quadrants, there is no concern for people and no concern for process. It's a process, whether it's like people, we can include ourselves, concern for improving ourselves and concern for how do I go about improving myself, or concern for improving others and how do I go about improving others. So if there is no concern for either people or process, that is nihilism. That nihilism is just life has no meaning, why do anything at all. Then if there is concern for process but not people, it is like, say, if you consider a surgeon who is extremely meticulous, that they want to follow all the protocols exactly. This is how the surgery is to be done, this is how it is to be done, this is how it is to be done, this. It's good to have concern for the process. But suppose the patient has some other complications because of which that process can't be followed. And you follow it, that's going to be a disaster for the patient. They say, no, this is what has to be followed. That's all that there is to it. Concern for people, not process. Concern for process, not for people. So these people usually become sentimentalists. Sorry, they become fanatical. They become fanatics. This is what has to be done. Their whole concern is, that's all. No questions asked. So there is very little concern for context over there. And such people can become very hard-hearted. Then there are others who are, there is concern for people but no concern for process. They are the people who become relativists. Okay, this doesn't work for you, just give it up. That works for you, do it. So there is only concern for people, no concern for process. So if this feels bad for you, just don't do it. So we could say that these are now fanatics and relativists. These are more extreme versions of these two. But you could also have conservatives and liberals. Liberals have a greater concern for people than process, and conservatives have a greater concern for process than people. And actually, both are needed. If you want to do a surgery, you have to follow the process. But you also have to see the background of the patient. And then you have to see how that process works for the person. If that particular surgery is just not going to work for the person, then what will happen? We'll have what is called operation successful, patient dead. Sometimes it happens that, it happened with me once that I was, there is always the zeal of the new convert. So I was just new to Krishna consciousness, maybe 1.5 years, and I was working in a company. So one of my colleagues, he had been a co-student with me in my college also. So both of us joined the same company. So I would go by the bus, it's a 1 hour ride, and he would join 2 stops later. And then when I was in that 1 hour ride, I would daily either chant or read or hear some class. I would not talk with anyone at all. And one day, this friend made the big mistake. His mistake was, he asked me, "What are you doing?" And then, in the next 1 hour, I gave him the ultimate crash course on Bhagavad-Gita. From the existence of God to the existence of soul, to the establishing that bhakti is the only way and Krishna is the only supreme God, and because the material world is filled with misery and the spiritual world is the source of all happiness. And I didn't even notice that his eyes were looking crazy. He's getting overwhelmed. Then after that, normally bus has 2 doors. So so after that, whenever he would climb into the bus, he would first peep in, see where I'm sitting, and then come in from the other door. So, I think 1.5-2 years ago, I met him in Seattle. And then his sister has become a devotee. Probably his sister undid the damage that I had done. So then we talked about it, we had a good laugh. I apologized to him. He said,
so what happens sometimes? We just think that, for some people, the idea of preaching is simply downloading a fixed program on everyone. This is it, just tell them, chant Hare Krishna and be happy. It's good, but you have to see where they're coming from. Is that message intelligible for them? Look at their context and then speak. So when they have that, when some people have that idea that this is the program, just download it on everyone. Then what happens is, the Bhagavad Gita verse applies, if we are, our preaching is successful, then the soul becomes liberated and yad gatva nivartante tad dhama paramam mama. But if our preaching is unsuccessful, same thing happens. Yad gatva na nivartante.
They go never to come back to the temple.
So we have to have concern for the process and concern for people both. Then that is, so the fourth quadrant would be the spiritualists. So those who are spiritual, they understand the process and they understand the purpose of the process. So yes, this is the protocol to be followed for the surgery. But ultimately, the point is not just to follow the protocol. The point is to heal the person. So the third quadrant would be somebody who says, the patient says, oh no, the surgery will cause me a lot of pain. So the doctor says, I won't do the surgery only. Well, no, we have to do it. We have to do it the proper way. So yes, fanatics are a problem, but sentimentalists are also a problem. So conservatives and liberals, both are needed. And in some cases, so who is right? There is no guarantee. There is no fixed answer. Sometimes it is the process that needs to be emphasized. We can't adjust everything. But sometimes it is people who need to be emphasized. Look at this person's context and then act accordingly. Does that answer your question? Thank you. Hare Krishna.
Those quadrants that you're explaining, that we need to encourage people to come out of the darkness and see the light. So, I mean, I put it in a very technical way, but in the process, sometimes in the process of encouraging new people so that they can take the moment positively, we tend to neglect the existing devotees. So we tend to neglect their needs. We tend to neglect how they are improving in the Krishna consciousness. So it happens a lot, many times. So would you please advise something, that how do we balance so that the existing devotees are also being taken care of and encouraged in the movement, so that they're also feeling, that, okay, I'm getting my nutritional food of encouragement.
Okay, yes. So how can we ensure that we don't just get new people, but we also encourage those who are practicing bhakti to move on? Yes, to some extent, we think of Krishna consciousness to be like an automatic process. It's like a railway. If it's come on the rail track, it will just automatically go to the destination. So our concern is just to get more and more compartments on the rail track. But then it will not automatically go, it can get derailed, it can get stalled. So we need to make sure not just that we get more and more souls on the highway to Krishna, expressway to Krishna, but we also help them to move onward. And for that purpose, we need to appreciate different definitions of success in bhakti. Traditionally, our movement has functioned based on three definitions of success. One is how many books are distributed, how many devotees are made, and how many temples are built, or how many devotees are made, you could say four definitions, how many temples are built or whatever, basically. So how many temples are built, how many devotees made, how many books distributed. That's three. So now these are all definitions in terms of outreach, getting new people to come. the resources. Books are distributing books as resources. Building temples or that is resource. Making devotees is also one thing. But Prabhupada himself said that we need to boil the milk. Now the problem is that boiling the milk is something which is not so easily quantifiable. And because we live in a very Rajasic culture, in the mode of passion, so it's much easier to motivate ourselves for doing things that have quantifiable results. So when we do outreach, there are quantifiable results. Oh, this many people came for a program. This much funds we raised to build a temple. Or this many books we distributed. But then if we sit and spend time with devotees, there's guhyam akhyati pruchyati. There's interaction among them. How are you going to quantify that? So we need to, so certain definitions of success will be highlighted or glamorized. Just like, say, in India, it is that if parents of an Aditya, the child doesn't become an engineer or doctor, then he's become a failure. It's like that. So in every society, certain definitions of success will be glamorized. And others will consequently be downplayed. But we as a community need to, even if there are certain definitions that are highlighted, we also need to appreciate other definitions of success. And Krishna will send people who will be inspired by particular definitions of success. Say for example, some devotees may get a lot of inspiration in they are more like crowd pullers. They can do big program and attract a lot of people. Now some devotees may be more comfortable and more expert in maybe teaching something like Bhakti Shastri. Where they take devotees Bhakti Shastri, Bhakti Vaibhava, they lead devotees deep into Shastra. And now this is how are we going to quantify this? Okay, so many devotees did Bhakti Shastri degree. Well, okay, but that's not going to be as glamorized as say, oh, this many new people came to the temple, or this many people took initiation, or whatever. So, if there are devotees in a community who are inspired by definitions of success which are centered on cultivating, centered on not just cultivating new people, but cultivating and nourishing existing devotees, then they need to be encouraged, they need to be facilitated. Whatever is appreciated will naturally be adopted. We all need encouragement in life. So if this is appreciated, everybody appreciates this, I want to do this. So we need to, so for example, if we have retreat programs for devotees, then they need to be appreciated. Then they need to be organized, and the organizers of those who take all that trouble, they need to be appreciated for that. Or whichever programs nourish devotees, we have to think what is it that will nourish devotees. And if we start in as a part of the community leaders, we can ourselves take it up, or we can encourage others to take it up. And who are doing that, we appreciate them. That's something which each one of us can do. And the more we start doing that, we'll find that the activities that nourish will also be done more and more. And sometimes it's again with care also, it's not uniform what will be felt as care by someone. For some devotees, it might be that just give them the facility to do outreach, give them the facility to reach out to a lot of new people, and that's what makes them feel cared. They don't come and sit and talk and tell me how things are going on. I want to go out and distribute books. Okay, that's what they want. And we facilitate, okay, I've got this contact for you, you can go at this book fair and do this. Oh, thank you very much. So we have to see that, what is it that devotees value, what is it that devotees appreciate. So it's one thing, as I said, we appreciate different definitions of success, and the definitions of success which are centered on cultivating and nourishing devotees, we appreciate those also. Another aspect is that for each devotee, there are certain things which make them feel nourished. And we need to understand devotees at an individual level also. Okay, what would make this devotee feel nourished? And then we see according to our capacity how much can we provide that. Prabhupada does say that in the nectar of instruction that Guhyam Akhyati Prachyati Parapod, that the Krishna consciousness movement is nourished by the sixfold loving exchanges. So those nakshis, especially hearing in confidence and letting others or speaking, revealing our heart in confidence, those are things which are very important. And if there are adequate forums for that, then that itself can be very nourishing. So we need to change that our definition of success. That okay, spending quality time with devotees, just hearing them, understanding them, that itself can make us feel nourished. So if we broaden our definition of success, then the internal nourishment can also happen more. Does that answer your question? Thank you. Anything else? Yes, please.
Thank you for this amazing discourse. I had one question. Listening to some discourses, there they said having doubts is a sign of intelligence.
Yes.
So, in that context, then also I heard that once you hear from the scriptures, from this, and still you have doubts, then you are like lost. So I just wanted to.
Okay. Good question. So, is having doubts a sign of intelligence? But then, if we keep hear scripture and still have doubt, we say we are lost. But the Bhagavatam in the third canto, in Kapila's teachings, Jesus say that samshayo atha viparyasa, that the characteristics of intelligence are doubt, then ascertainment, and then it goes on. So it's only a wise person can doubt. Say for example, you get a email which says, just reply to this email and you will get $1 million. I'll get $1 million, great. Now on the internet, whenever any product is offered free, then usually it is we are the product who are being bought. It is our time, our consciousness, our attachments that are being entangled. So it requires wisdom to doubt. So we could consider that if we are driving, then when we are driving, there is the car has a gas, has accelerator, and it has a brake. So the accelerator is faith, and doubt is the brake. So while we are driving, we need to have both functional. If the car is, if I'm driving and I'm going off the track, if everything has become bumpy and jerky, and am I going on the right track? Maybe I need to put a brake and slow down. So we need brake when we are hearing something and it doesn't make sense. Oh, stop. What's going on? Can you explain this? It's a doubt. So doubt is, if we are hearing intelligently, will we have doubts. If we are hearing completely passively, that means something comes in from one ear, and then it just, for some people at least it goes out through the other ear, it goes out the same ear only. Then we will have no doubts, isn't it? So, when that happens, so it's when we hear intelligently, then we'll have some doubts. So doubts are like brakes. However, the problem is not doubts. So doubt is a sign of intelligence, but doubt is not the only sign of intelligence. That means if somebody just presses the brake and doesn't release it only, then they will not get anywhere. So if we are on the wrong track, or we are going off track, we need to press the brake. But we can't keep pressing the brake all the time. So doubts are the sign of intelligence, but if we never put faith. So it's interesting, Krishna says that Shraddhavan Labhate Jnanam. In 440 he says, it is the faithful who gain knowledge. That means, it's like if I am going from going on a journey from darkness to light, from ignorance to knowledge, then I have to have some faith. Okay, if I read this book, if I hear this class, I'll gain some understanding. That's why faith is like the accelerator. But some people, if they just don't use their intelligence, they say, I have faith. But then it's like they're driving without any brake. So faith is good, but faith should be accompanied by the use of intelligence. Does that answer your question?
Yes.
Thank you. Yes, we had a question.
Hey, can you please emphasize on the point that apara is more dangerous than sin?
Okay. How is apara or offense more dangerous than sin? Generally, sin is what has it's bad karma. It has karmic consequences. So we do wrong and we get some results of that. But aparad is something which takes us away from Krishna, which replaces our attraction for Krishna with either apathy for Krishna or aversion to Krishna. And say even if somebody has done something wrong, if still they are attracted to Krishna, then they will come back and they will purify themselves. That's the import of that verse 9:30 and 31 in the Bhagavad Gita, where Krishna says, Apichech sudaracharo bhajate mam ananya bhak sadhureva samantavya samyak vyavasito hi saha. So even if somebody does something wrong and grievously wrong, but if they stay determined, I am going to serve Krishna. This is a terrible thing that I did. I regret, but I am going to serve Krishna. Then that connection with Krishna will purify them and will establish them in dharma. But if somebody commits aparad to Krishna's devotees, then they lose their taste for Krishna and then they will never get purified. So then sooner or later the world's temptations will attract them and drag them down further. So in that sense, offending devotees or offending Krishna is more dangerous than simply doing wrongs. Does that answer your question? Thank you. Yes, Mata, I had a question. So, thank you very much for your attention and participation. It is wonderful being here in Columbus. Is that a comment or a question? So, thank you very much.
I would like to ask the last question, Maharaj. You said that there are four classes of people surrender to Krishna. And practically, the Krishna devotees, or the preachers in Krishna consciousness, our preaching is more emphasized on one who is actually looking for Krishna. Now, how do we attract the three categories? How do you get them to Krishna?
Okay, is it that when we are trying to share Krishna consciousness, we are focusing on those who are looking for Krishna? Not necessarily looking for Krishna, but at least looking for something higher. It has to be there, because at one level, we can say that everybody needs to be pushed a little bit. But for some people, you push them and they come to Krishna. For some people, you push them and they go away from Krishna. So then what do we do? How much can we push someone? So for somebody is in distress, then at that time if we are there as friends, as counselors, not necessarily preachers, but as friendly, concerned human beings, then that can also help them. But in general, in today's world especially, if somebody is distressed, they can go to a psychologist. If they need money, they can go to a bank and take loan. If they have curiosity, they can just Google. And now these three factors alone themselves may not bring people to Krishna. So it's they have distress and they have some spiritual interest. That's why they look for something higher. They have curiosity, but they also have some spiritual inclination. So we also try to create that spiritual inclination by distributing books, by doing Harinam, by Jagannath Rath Yatra, and which give people spiritual impressions. But it is true that there has to be some inclination for searching for something higher. It's like, say, somebody is trying to drive a car and the car is not starting. So at that time, say, in India it happens that say people come around and they all push the car. So people from outside are pushing, the person from inside is steering and maneuvering, and then the car starts off. And then the person moves on the journey. But suppose the people from outside are pushing and the person from inside has gone to sleep. They are not trying at all. Or worse still, people from outside are pushing and the person from inside is pressing the brake. Then what can you do? There's not much point in pushing. Still, if somebody is not at all interested in Krishna, that doesn't mean we have to reject them. But we didn't, so we don't need to push them further. So when we interact with people, if they are not interested in Krishna, if we can just give them a positive impression, I met a nice person, then maybe in future they'll want to explore more. So we can open the door for Krishna, for people to come toward Krishna. And if they don't come, then we can just be courteous and close the interaction on a positive note. What we should not do, and what we unfortunately often do, is that if we open the door for Krishna and they don't come, then we bang the door in their face. You are in Maya, you are going to go to hell, this, that. And then that is very alienating. So yes, people need to have some spiritual interest. Otherwise it's very, very difficult. Then we can try to create a Gyan Sukruti by giving prasad, by doing Harinam, by giving books. It's a more gradual process. So thank you very much. Shila Prabhupada ki
jai.
Gaura Bhakta Vrinda ki
jai.
Gaura Premanande. Hare Hare.